It's kind of funny, you know, the idea of being a success, you know, in front of these people, because, you know, I went to film school, and I didn't make it. I do this now. We have one office in one country. But I make beer. I win. It's an interesting path, you know, and it's been an interesting time. You know, I feel very lucky, you know, doing what it is that I do. And of course, you know, you go to a party or whatever else, people always ask you, well, how do you become a brewmaster? As if people really thought about being that when they were in college, because everybody does, in a certain way. But most brewmasters that I know didn't start there. And so I'll take you quickly through what my path was, because it is certainly circuitous. My first beer I had when I was about 12 years old. I used to go to my Uncle Bill's house, and the thing we always asked him since I was 9, can I have a beer, can I have a beer, can I have a beer? He drank Miller High Life. It was in the gold can. It looked like it must be obviously wonderful because he drank quite a bit of it. Everybody at the barbecue did. They seemed very happy. So, you know, I figured this is the stuff that I need. So finally, one day after hearing me over and over and over again, can I have something? It's like, fine, here. And he hands it to me. I'm like, great. I spat it into the grass. And that was my last beer for about, I don't know, 5-6 years. And then, you know, I went to college and I drank beer. We didn't like it, but we drank it. Now, to give you some idea, we drank Budweiser when we had money. When we didn't have money, which was almost all the time, we drank something called Hoffenreffer, also known as the Green Death. Yeah, you've suffered the Green Death, have you? We drank Mickey's Big Mouth. We drank all sorts of things, and but I made it through. I mean, we knew where all the drink specials were every night. You know, it's, you know, Tuesday at Molly's. It's kamikaze night. You know, so like most students, you know, I didn't care much about beer. It was there. You drank it. And then I graduated in 1983 with my film degree, and unlike Nyla, I decided that this qualified me to drive any color cab that I wanted, and I figured that I didn't really know anything yet, and if I was going to be confused, I should do it in style someplace else where my parents couldn't see me. So I moved to London. This was after working for a summer at HBO, and they promised me a job in London. It didn't happen. I ended up stage managing rock bands, which I knew how to do, as I had run all the entertainment for Boston University. But when I was there, I fell in love with the institution of the pub. And for those of you who've spent time in England, you'll know the pub is not a bar. It's a different place, and it's hard to describe exactly what makes it different. There are any number of things. But for me, one of the main things was the beer. And the beer is what many Americans think of as being warm and flat. In fact, it's lightly carbonated, naturally carbonated, and it's cool rather than cold. And the first time I got a pint of this stuff, it looked like a fishbowl with a handle on it. I mean, the British pint is huge, so, you know, more than 19 ounces. And I drank it, and it was weird. And then it was like, oh, hay and sea air and fruit and whatever else. I don't know if I like this. Ooh, it's gone. I better get another one to see whether I like it. And everybody talked about beer. They weren't beer fans, but they talked about it like it was the weather. You go into the pub, and if the beer was good, that meant that you were staying. And if the beer was bad, it was like a storm was coming on, one pint, maybe half a pint, get the hell out of here. And that was because I learned later that the beer was alive, that it had undergone a secondary fermentation in the cask, in the cellar, and it was moving on through its life, and that somebody had made this stuff. And they called it real ale. And this was to differentiate it from the sorts of beers that people had started to make. They had started to make more industrial, fizzy beers, and people wanted the old beer back. And they started a movement called the Campaign for Real Ale, which essentially, this is a long story, but I'll make it short, they brought the British brewing industry to their knees. They basically boycotted and said, we won't go to the pub unless you bring our beer back. And it was amazing to see that passion. And then I got home, I came back to New York, and there was nothing to drink. This was 1983. There wasn't any Sam Adams, there wasn't any all these breweries that you see now. In the year 1900, there were 48 breweries in Brooklyn. There were more than 2,000 breweries in the United States. By 1974, there were 40 breweries left in the entire country, and they made one kind of beer.